All right, Alexander, we need to talk about U.S. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo's long visit to Greece. This is the second trip he's made to Greece, I believe, in a month or 2 months. I mean, we're going to start giving him a passport soon because he's coming to Greece so often. It's really remarkable. I've never seen a U.S. Secretary of State visit Greece so often. But anyway, this one's a really long trip too, and it comes at a time when you have tensions in the East Med, even though it looks like Greece and Turkey will be sitting down at the negotiation table to figure out a way around the tension that has been brewing in the East Med. But it does come at a time when you have what's going on at the East Med. It also comes at a time right now where you also have a conflict between Armenia and Azerbaijan, where Turkey has inserted itself into that conflict as well. Of course, you have issues that are going on in Iraq, in Iran, in Syria, where the U.S. is spread out all over the area. But it really seems that the Greek-U.S. relationship has never been better. Is that a good thing? Is that a bad thing? Our viewers can chime in the comments down below. A few headlines that I will read for you, Alexander. First off, it's worth noting that when Pompeo did arrive to Thessaloniki, which is the major city up north, he was greeted with protests from RT. Greek police clashed with protesters at rally against Pompeo's visit to Athens. And it was in Thessaloniki Airport, but there were protests as well in Athens. But I have to qualify it and say that the protests were mostly peaceful and they weren't very large. I will say that, whether Athens or Thessaloniki. There were mostly left-wing groups that were protesting and they had signs including words like Pompeo is unwanted and Yankee go home. But for the most part, I can tell you that they weren't very big. Anyway, in Thessaloniki, Alexander, he met with his counterpart, Nikos Dendias, the Greek foreign minister. And a tweet from Pompeo said, "Always fantastic to see Greek foreign minister Nikos Dendias today in Thessaloniki. We discussed the enduring strength of the U.S.-Greek relationship, the Western Balkans, and de-escalation of tensions in the Eastern Mediterranean." I forgot to mention there are tensions brewing as well in the Balkans as well. And then Pompeo made his way to Crete, where he met with Prime Minister Mitsotakis. And they met in Souda, Crete. And Pompeo said it was the first time that a U.S. Secretary of State has visited Greece twice in such a short space of time. He made a special reference to the very strong military relationship between Greece and the United States. I am taking this from the website Keep Talking Greece. And a tweet from Pompeo in Crete said this: "Deeply impressed by my visit to Souda Bay, thanks to the mutual defense cooperation agreement with Nikos Dendias and I signed last year, our military-to-military relationship has been enhanced significantly. The strong NATO alliance continues to contribute to regional security." Has the U.S. bet on Greece to be the go-to country when it comes to security within the region, Alexander?
Well, I think to some extent, yes. I mean, first of all, the important thing to say is that Greece is not, in the nature of things, a big, big country. I mean, it's about 10 million people. So this is an enormous amount, extraordinary amount of attention from the U.S. Secretary of State to Greece. And bear in mind, he is, there's elements of a tour here. He goes to Thessaloniki, which is in the north, and then he goes to Crete, which is in the south, and which is one of the big islands. So he's both in the mainland and in the islands, and he's in the north and he's in the south, and he meets the foreign minister and he meets the prime minister. And this is a very, very intense interaction. And as he himself says, it comes after another visit to Greece that took place not very long ago. So this is an intense amount of interest and attention by the United States in Greece. And it shows that the United States is at the moment very interested in Greece and very supportive of Greece. Now, you know, there are people in Greece who don't like that. I mean, there is always a strong anti-American, subculture in Greece, as there is in many European countries, by the way. But, you know, in Greece, it certainly exists, and much of it is left wing and some of it is very left wing. But nonetheless, I think at a time when there are tensions with Turkey and serious tensions with Turkey, which is a big, you know, military power, large country, 80 million people with, you know, large armed forces, this visit by the US Secretary of State at this time is undoubtedly a show of support for Greece. And I think it is a timely show of support for Greece from a Greek point of view. So, you know, I know some people in Greece may not like the United States very much. I don't think, by the way, they are anywhere near to being the majority. But the fact remains that this is good for Greece. I can't put it in any other way, because, you know, when you have someone like Erdogan at your door, having the support of the United States is always a positive thing. I mean, France is an important ally, as we said, you know, in earlier broadcasts. You know, they've sent their fleet there. They've, you know, done all sorts of things. But the United States is another level of power entirely. So from the Greek point of view, this is a good thing. And the fact that the Greeks have so successfully positioned themselves as, you know, the pivot for the United States of its power in the Eastern Mediterranean at a time when there are clearly issues between Greece and Turkey, is, it must be said, a diplomatic victory for Greece.
All right. So a lot of this definitely has to do with energy in the East Med. That's without a doubt. Mm-hmm. A lot of the anger with this visit is actually, I think, is directed towards the person of Mike Pompeo, mm-hmm. rather than the United States. Even though, yes, there is a portion of the population in Greece that has traditionally been anti-American. A lot of people may not know it, but Greece does have a very vibrant and active communist movement, and a very vibrant and active radical left. I mean, we had a radical left for a while, even though he turned out to be a neoliberal globalist radical left. Yeah. Nonetheless, he came from a radical left party before Mitsotakis was Tsipras. Can Mike Pompeo be trusted as he's, you know, building this very very tight connection with Greece, the United States with Greece? Is this bigger than Mike Pompeo? Is this really coming at a pay grade above Mike Pompeo's? Is this a presidential initiative? Is this even bigger than that? Is this a U.S. deep state foreign policy shift to say, you know what, it doesn't matter who's going to be in the White House or who's going to be Secretary of State, the United States of America has decided that the way it was doing things 5-10 years ago, i.e. mostly using Turkey, is now going to shift more towards Greece?
Yes, I think for the moment that is the policy. And I think that there is a consensus behind it right across Washington. I think both parties, the Democrats and the Republicans, support it. I think all the elements of the deep state support it. I think Donald Trump supports it. I don't think there's any issue about that. The only thing I will say is, if there's a change in Turkey, which could happen at any time, Turkey is a very volatile place, and a more accommodating leader comes to power in Turkey, accommodating from the perspective of the United States, then that policy could shift literally from one day to the next. So I think Greeks need to be aware of that. I mean, the United States, I think it was John Foster Dulles who once said that the United States doesn't have permanent friends, but it does have permanent interests. It does have an interest in its own position in the Eastern Mediterranean. Traditionally, it's looked to Turkey to secure it. Turkey is looking very unreliable because Erdogan is so unreliable. So they've turned to that other much more stable ally, which is Greece, which, by the way, it's important to stress, it has had its issues with the United States in the past. It has, as you rightly say, a vibrant communist movement, and it has all kinds of radical people in Greece. But it has been a US ally consistently since the end of the Greek Civil War in the 1940s, which the United States played a big role in. So it has been a stable, long-standing ally of the United States, may have had periods of tension, but there's never been a leader in Athens who has been as volatile and unpredictable and dangerous as Erdogan has been. So at the moment, it is in US interests, clearly, to have a good relationship with Greece. And, Crete, by the way, is a place which the US fleet, the Sixth Fleet, uses a lot. So, you know, going to Greece, going to Crete, going to Souda Bay, to Souda is a sign of that. It's a reminder of that. But, you know, if Turkey shifts again, which it could easily do, then this relationship might change. You know, might change again, and the United States might rediscover Turkey as its great ally. But for today, for the moment, Greece needs US support, and it's got it. It's achieved it. So this has been, it must be said, a success for the Greek government's diplomacy.
It's really interesting to see Greece break away from the European Union in a way. I haven't seen, the last, say, 10 years, I've just seen Greece kind of, you know, just sit there behind, you know, Merkel and just follow her around like a little lapdog. And all the EU technocrats and bureaucrats. And Greece hasn't really had much of its own foreign policy in the last 10 years. I would say pretty much zero foreign and domestic policy, to be honest. And given the fact that it's $350 billion in debt, it's been like that for 10 years, I wasn't expecting Greece to do anything significant outside of the EU. But this is, it's really interesting to see Greece kind of operate outside of the EU for the first time in a long time. And what's the game plan here for the US? Is it to seal up the East Med and you're going to just, you know, have Israel, Cyprus, Greece, France, as you know, your go-to team? This is going to be your, and each of these are going to be your starting four, starting five players, and the U.S. is just going to provide an umbrella of protection, military protection, maybe even financial and investment protection, and thus you keep Russia out, and you go after the European energy market in that way. Is that the game plan, or is there something more that's going on here with this courtship of Greece? I mean, are you telling Turkey, you know what, either you're with us or we're cutting you loose?
I think there is an element of that. I mean, I think a lot of Americans are very, very exasperated by Erdogan. Erdogan has exasperated many people on all sides, but the US is extremely annoyed with Erdogan for all kinds of reasons. And I think, you know, this is partly a tactical maneuver by the United States. Turkey isn't as reliable as it was. Greece has always been reliable. And so it makes sense for the United States to strengthen its ties with Greece at a time when, as you rightly say, there are major energy, energy investments and developments happening in the Eastern Mediterranean. And when Greece is also playing potentially, or could play potentially, a big role in the Balkans, in the Western Balkans, where things are heating up. So for the US, it makes sense at the moment to work with Greece. How long this will go on for, I think, depends a lot on what happens in Turkey. But I think US actions are predictable. Perhaps Greek actions are more interesting, because you're absolutely right. This is Greece once again, acting as its own country. It's no longer hiding within the EU. It's no longer subordinating its foreign policy to the EU. It's actually carrying out diplomacy on its own. And it's such a contrast because, of course, the previous Greek prime minister, Alexis Tsipras, even though he came to power supposedly as the person who was going to break away from the, you know, tutelage of the, you know, the so-called Troika, the European Central Bank and the Commission and all that. In fact, he proved an absolutely loyal and reliable ally of Merkel's. He was, in fact, Merkel's stooge, and he did exactly whatever it was that Merkel told him. Whereas the new government, the government that replaced him, the Mitsotakis government, looks differently. It goes to more traditional allies. So it looks to the United States and it looks to France, and it isn't so fixated with the European Union. Now, it's not an anti-EU government by any means. Perhaps more wisely than Tsipras, it knows that you don't pick fights that you can't win with the Germans, at least fights you don't, you know, you can't win, or you don't have the stomach to win, because Tsipras didn't have the stomach to win those fights. I mean, that was the truth about it. I mean, he was a... we won't talk about Tsipras, but this is a much more serious approach to diplomacy and to politics. So they're not breaking with the EU, but they're saying, well, you know, the world doesn't start and end in Brussels. Berlin isn't the only capital that matters. Washington is a more important place. And Paris is an old and reliable friend. We've also got good relations with Israel now. Let's actually behave like the sovereign country that we are and not let the EU, i.e. Merkel, make all the decisions for us and have a prime minister who is essentially just Miss Merkel's postman, who comes along and transmits her messages to the bureaucracy here, which then does what Miss Merkel wants. So that's the change, that's the difference. And it is an interesting one. And it's not one I would have expected from Mitsotakis and from the government that he leads.
Yeah, my final question is, I wonder what's going to happen when push comes to shove. And what do I mean by that? If you know who Mitsotakis is, you know, he's a product of the United States. He was educated in the U.S. I believe he's very American-oriented in his thinking and in who he is. I mean, his English is near fluent, if not fluent. He is definitely a product of the U.S. But what happens in scenarios that may take place in the next few years in a very unstable world that we live in, where you could have tensions flare up in the Balkans and you have a United States that is very antagonistic towards, say, Serbia, but you have a Greece that is very friendly and very supportive of Serbia? What happens then when push comes to shove? What happens when and if the U.S. continues to butt heads with Russia and, you know, Greece has a very close relationship with Russia as well? You know, what happens then with Greece? What happens when Russia comes along and Lavrov comes to Athens and he tells Greece, says, yes, you know, I understand that you guys are with the United States here, but we want to get in on the energy action in the East Med. And we are, after all, Orthodox countries. We've been allies and brotherly nations for decades and centuries. What happens when push comes to shove? How does Greece, you know, how do they create this balancing act? How do they balance this out?
Well, you know, capable Greek leaders in the past have known how to do that. I mean, if you look in, you know, previous periods of Greek history, you know, if you go back to people like Venizelos, who was the great Greek prime minister of the interwar years, he was able to balance the various powers with immense skill. And there have been others too. I mean, you know, Karamanlis was a very, very effective at that kind of thing. He was very good at playing this. Mitsotakis has to be careful not to overcommit too deeply to one side. I mean, at the moment, the strategy he's following of being close to the United States is, I think, the right one. I think it works for Greece, given how dangerous the situation with Turkey potentially is. So I think it's the right policy. But you always got to understand that the interests of Greece have to require you to be on good terms with more than just one country and more with than just one power bloc. And if there is a crisis in the Balkans, for example, and it involves Serbia, which is a country about which Greeks feel very strongly, then, of course, you can't expect the Greek people necessarily to support a pro-American policy, which is very strongly anti-Serb. And any government that tries to do that potentially could come very easily unstuck. And even if they did, if they were able to see it through, I'm not sure how it helps Greece to have a broken or weakened Serbia. Likewise, you know, with Russia, I mean, at the moment, you know, the Russians, as you rightly say, I mean, you know, they've got all kinds of issues at the moment with Erdogan. They've got complicated issues in the Caucasus, but they'll be back. They always are. They're always a constant. Greece can't, again, completely give up good relationships with them. And this isn't just a cultural or a historic thing, though that should not be discounted. But the Russians are big players in this part of the world. And again, if the United States were one day, for example, to return to its historic and very close relationship with Turkey, who do you turn to then? So I think Mitsotakis, we haven't yet seen how he will, you know, run things in the long term, or even whether he will be prime minister for the long term. At the moment, his policy is beneficial for Greece. I mean, I say that without any equivocation at all. But he's got to always understand that Greece cannot afford to overcommit to one side against another. And I'm going to add something else. I mean, you know, I said that this is a policy that is supported right across the board in the United States. And that is true. But if we get a Joe Biden as president in November, Joe Biden might want, for example, to repair relations with the European Union. He might want to repair relations with Merkel. He might be less interested in supporting a more independent Greek foreign policy from Brussels and Berlin than Donald Trump and Mike Pompeo are. So there are always these nuances to keep in mind and to understand that at the moment, we have in Washington, or Greece has in Washington, a friendly administration, but that might not always be so. And the United States always can change its policies at any time.
Yeah, that's a very good point. I think a Biden administration, God help us, would be essentially an Obama administration. Yeah. That would definitely default to the EU. It wouldn't consider, it would be a globalist outlook, so it wouldn't consider individual sovereign states' policies. It would just default to the globalist institution, which would be the EU. And it sounds to me, Alexander, the wild card that you always have to keep an eye out for is Turkey.
Absolutely.
What happens in Turkey is that wild card.
Absolutely. It is indeed. I mean, you know, this is the question. We just don't know. I mean, Turkey is a volatile country, to put it mildly. I mean, my instinct actually is that I've not said this before, but I'm starting to think that Erdogan may be running out of road. I mean, this adventure he's launched in the Caucasus, it looks an incredibly reckless one. And, you know, the economic crisis in Turkey is deepening. He still has a lot of support in Turkey. He has a lot of institutional support in Turkey. But I wonder how much longer he will be there. And when he is gone, I have a deep feeling that whatever Turkish leader or leadership replaces him will want to pivot Turkey back towards a more conventional relationship with its old established allies, which are the United States and the Western powers. So that's something that a Greek leadership needs to take into account.
Yeah, that would change everything.
Yeah.
All right, we'll leave it there. Alexander Merkouris, thank you very much. Guys, if you like this video, click on that subscribe button, smash that like, and please comment on this video. Let us know what you think about this video and what we have said. Also, please donate to us on PayPal, Patreon, and Subscribestar. Your donation really helps us out. It helps us get news stories like this out to you. And also go to the Duran shop. That also helps us out when you pick up some merchandise.
Indeed it does. And here we have a mug with the flag of the United States. And Alex has got one with the flag of Greece. And of course, so have I. So you see, there we go. The United States and Greece, the two countries that are at the moment, once again, the best of friends. And in fact, they've always been friends. And of course, as our American Greek viewers probably know, there are lots and lots of Greeks in the United States who are proud to be Greeks, and they're proud to be Americans also. So there's a large Greek community in the United States, and it's a vibrant and important community, both for the US and for the greater Greek world. So we've got all our mugs with all our flags. We've got, as we saw, large mugs and small mugs, and we've also got enameled mugs. This one with the flag of England, which is one of the component parts, in fact, far and away the biggest component part of the United Kingdom of Great Britain. Our porcelain mugs, perfect for drinking, you know, hot chocolate or beer or champagne from. And you can see they come in different sizes now. Our enameled mugs, perfect also for taking outdoors if you go picnicking or you want to go into the forests or the woods or you know, on the beach or on the mountains or wherever. So we've got flags of many shapes and sizes, all of superb quality, with lots and lots of flags. You'll find lots of flags of many countries now. Before long, you're bound to find your own flag if it isn't there already. And if it still isn't there before long, you can always drop us a line and let us know. And we will do what we can to accommodate you. And it's not just, of course, our mugs that have flags. We also have them on all sorts of other things, like our hat I'm wearing now. As Alex will always tell you, the Oracle of London, or so he says. And you will see that there is the flag of the United Kingdom, of which London is the proud capital. And I've also got another one of these amazing hats, and it's also got the flag of the United Kingdom on it too. And by the way, it was an incredibly bright day today in London, beautiful day. I was out walking my dogs and I had this particular hat, and it was marvelous. It was absolutely what you need when the sun is shining bright and keeps it out of your eyes. So we've got baseball hats, we've got trucker's hats, we've got, as you saw, embroidered hats, hats with the flags of many nations. We have our amazing Duran shirts, all 100% cotton, some long-sleeved, as you see, like this one, others short-sleeved, amazing polo shirts, the best polo shirts in the world. We've got hoodies, and we've also got our amazing ebooks. You can find all of these wonderful things in our shop, and at the same time, you support the Duran by buying things from our shop. So come to our shop, buy these great things, support the Duran, give all your support to our struggling and brave channel that brings you all this wonderful news and analysis, and Alex will tell you how.
You'll find a link to the Duran shop down below in the description box. Alexander Merkouris, the Oracle of London, thank you very much. Until next time, everybody, take care.